Hello, fellow students of Jewish history. You know, I've been conducting research for the upcoming Ron cruise, and I came across something yesterday that just blew my mind, that even though it's not dealing with the Ron material, it's in a very close by area, the region of Bordeaux and Bayonne, which we will be going to, God willing, next year. It was just such a fascinating thing. I figured I've got to do more research on this, and I can't wait to share it with you. So let me talk a little bit about the region of Bordeaux, and specifically to the south, the region of Bayonne. I was reading a one-volume study of French Jewry by Esther Benbassa, a fascinating historian who is also a politician. She is a senator in France. And I came across this amazing story of the Jews of a place called Saint-Esprit-les-Bayons. I chased down an article by Anne Zink on this to read a little more, and it's just absolutely amazing. So this place, Saint-Esprit-les-Bayons, you can see where it is here, sort of like perched on the very western edge of France, just above the border with Spain. That, by the way, gives it a very important role later in the colonization of the Americas, and Jews were part of that story, and I'll return to that in a second. It's also especially important because it was the destination for a lot of Portuguese Jews. And let's just quickly explore why they're coming to this spot specifically. Let's recall, Jews were not allowed in France at the time that the Portuguese Jews began to move there. The Jews were expelled from, and France is not unified like it is today. There are different, you know, territories controlled by different powers and so on. But basically, the Jews are expelled first in 1182 and then invited back, and it goes, they're expelled again several times until the end of the 14th century. And in Provence, the region that's close by here, finally expelled at the beginning of the 16th century. However, there's a little footnote in that King Louis XI wanted to resettle the region of Bordeaux, which was devastated by the Hundred Years' War. So in 1474, he invites foreigners, except the hated English, to return to Bordeaux and to settle then. And there he explicitly allows the so-called Portuguese merchants. And later they're openly called Portuguese New Christians. They are given residency rights in this region of Bordeaux and Bayonne. Now, who are these Portuguese merchants, also known as Portuguese New Christians? These are essentially Jews who were forcibly converted in 1497 in Portugal and were looking for ways to get out of that country. And many of them made their way to more hospitable climes like Amsterdam, for example. We've spoken about that quite a bit. And many of them went out to the New World, to Brazil and other places. But this is really close by. It's just over the Pyrenees, just over the border. And there's a lot of these Jews who are given technically the rights of Christians, but still wishing at some level to live as Jews. These are called crypto-Jews. They used to be called Marranos, which is in itself a derogatory term meaning swine. So crypto-Jews or conversos is considered a more acceptable term. They're Jews who, they're along a whole spectrum. There are some who really become true believers and are ultimately absorbed into the larger Catholic population. There are those who deeply, deeply resent the forcible conversion and are doing everything they can to live underground as Jews. And then there's a whole bunch of Jews who are in the middle of that, who are trying to like maintain their safety as living as Christians to the outside world, but in their own homes, they're still marrying other crypto Jews, practicing some Jewish traditions, and so on. So they're making their way now to the region of Bordeaux-Bayonne. Everybody knows that they are of Jewish extraction, and there's a degree of persecution that goes along with that, even though they are technically baptized. We know that the Jews were useful. Like, look at this chart here. You can see that in 1751, 51% of the Jews, there were a very small number of them, were impoverished. Almost all of them were, you know, producing and for the economy. About half of them are involved in trade. About 30% are involved in banking. That is a little bit skewed from what we see in other parts of Europe where Jews are allowed to live. Banking and small commerce might be a little bit larger, but nevertheless, there's 12% involved in crafts and 5% involved in other things. In terms of the trade, you know, this is Saint-Esprit is on an important river that opens out into the Atlantic, so they're involved in all kinds of things, in wool sales, in chocolate, in tobacco, and You know, you name it, they're making soap, all kinds of things are going on there, and they are definitely very useful to the economy. So by 1550, King Henri II specifically assures their residency rights, even though they are Portuguese New Christians. Now, what's especially interesting about all this is that what's going on in Bordeaux and Bayonne is not necessarily what's going on in the entire country. By 1615, King Louis XIII requires all Jews, including crypto Jews, to leave France. And that, by the way, affects a lot of the Jews who have made their way to the New World. A lot of French holdings, like in Louisiana and elsewhere, Jews are technically expelled from those regions as well. But in Bordeaux, here's the really interesting part. In Bordeaux, the Jews are allowed to remain there because the local parliament refuses to obey the king on the expulsion of the Jews. And in fact, they develop a legal remedy. They sell naturalization rights to Portuguese merchants. 260 of them take advantage of this, and they buy the right to be naturalized in Bordeaux specifically. And essentially, they just sort of ignore the king on this regard. And by 1723, the people living there are openly referred to as Jews, despite the fact that the legal ban on their settlement in French territory is still fully in place. It's absolutely amazing. The legal nomenclature of what we call them, Portuguese merchants or New Christians or even Jews, reflects a reality that is developing on the ground in Bordeaux. Throughout the 17th century, all kinds of measures that are cataloged in an exhaustive manner by Anne Zink, who really went down into the local archives, demonstrates that they are more and more openly returning to their Jewish practices. For example, birth rates seem to be pretty much stable, but the number of baptisms, especially baptisms in Portuguese families, declines. They employ a parish priest to serve as this kind of go-between to buy a plot of land to allow them to have their own cemetery with their own Chevra Kaddish and their rites, and they develop all kinds of, you know, traditional institutions like you would have in a much more well-developed Kehillah in, let's say, Jewish Eastern Europe. So by the last quarter of the 18th century, the Jews of Bordeaux are openly flouting what's going on in the rest of France. They're living without any restrictions on their movement within Bordeaux and Bayonne. They can own real estate. They don't have to wear the rouelle, the Jewish badge. They don't have to wear the yellow hat. They have, you know, an incredible amount of freedoms within this region. Now, I want to point out one thing here that we can't miss this. Just think about this. I was just describing things that happens at the end of the 1700s. But they were the descendants of people who were forcibly converted at the end of the 1400s. So we're talking about 300 years, right? From, let's say, 1500 to 1800. So we're talking about how many generations is that? If a generation is about 25 years, that's three times, that's 12 generations. I mean, can you imagine living as a submerged identity for 12 generations? And if you want to say that the Jews were sort of coming out of the woodwork in 1800, well, you know, it's been a good century of tolerance in Bordeaux and Bayonne, much greater, I would think, in many ways than the famed convivencia that you see in the south in Spain during the Muslim period. But that's still 100 years after that started. So if we go back 100 years, they're still talking about 8 generations. Couldn't you imagine returning to your ancestral identity after 8 generations of living as a submerged individual? It really is mind-boggling. Here's the thing that Anne Zink really drives home in her article on this topic. And maybe she's thinking of the darker history of the 20th century, when this kind of tolerance was sadly hardly in evidence. The fact is that national leaders, kings and so on, can make all kinds of pronouncements. They can make so-called political statements. They can pronounce ideological purity, like saying, hey, France is going to be Judenrein. We are going to be completely Catholic. And of course, France had a lot of difficulty with non-Catholic Christians as well. But it only really matters when it can be enforced on the ground. And if there is a gap between these national leaders who are playing to all kinds of different agendas and the people who actually live there together with their Jewish neighbors. If there is a gap, if there's any daylight between those two positions, that's a moment in which you can have real humanity express itself. The non-Jewish population of Bordeaux and Bayonne saw the Jews in the 17th and 18th century as essentially their neighbors. We know that they were linguistically very well adapted, that, you know, looking at Anzinck's studies of rental agreements and purchase agreements and all kinds of contracts, that Jews were basically treated like every other citizen of Bordeaux and Bayonne. And so it's especially fascinating to see how these crypto-Jews were able to emerge from their submerged identity and yet find a welcome place in this corner of France. Wow, I can't wait to visit it. Thank you very much for watching this video.